Thank you, Nilesh. Thank you to the organizers. It's a truly a privilege to be sharing the podium with these expert panelists. Thank you for giving me the easiest job here. I'm talking about anti-TNF medications, and as you'll see, I'll start off with the take-home points because I think we all know this pretty well. Anti-TNF agents are the most effective first-line agents for Crohn's disease. We'll go into the evidence for this. The next point is that effective disease control is the best strategy to avoid infectious complications. So don't demonize the drug, control the disease better. And every treatment strategy that we know of that modifies the natural history of Crohn's disease is based on anti-TNF agents, and everything else is purely extrapolation. So what do we know about the comparative efficacy? So the evidence to derive this comparative efficacy was based on the Cochrane review. The first medication that we had up until 5 years ago were the three anti-TNF agents, and this sort of puts all of these medications next to each other against placebo, which is in yellow, and this is induction of remission for biologic-naive patients. And then in 2014 came vedolizumab, based off of two pivotal induction studies and one maintenance study, and the numbers are there for you to review. And finally, last year, we had ustekinumab, which was approved 40% rates of induction of remission as compared to 20% for placebo. Now, we really don't have too many head-to-head studies, so we have to rely on indirect evidence. Traditional pairwise meta-analyses do not give us this information because they compare drug A to drug B, but do not necessarily inform the entire body of evidence. And this is where I shouldn't call it a new technique. This has been around for close to 15, 20 years, a technique called network meta-analysis, which combines direct evidence, if available, based on head-to-head trials, and indirect evidence anchoring against a common comparator. In the case of IBD therapies, at least for biologics, it's largely placebo. And you get the entire body of evidence relative to placebo, and you can inform the comparative efficacy of these different agents. So that's what we based our subsequent slides on. This next bar graph is gonna be looking at first-line therapy, so biologic-naive patients for induction of remission. Stacking all medications together versus placebo, what we see here consistently is that infliximab and adalimumab, the two anti-TNF agents most commonly used, have the highest effect estimate, odds ratio of 5.9 over placebo for induction of remission for infliximab and 3.8 for adalimumab. And Sucra ranking is basically higher the Sucra, the closer it is to one, the higher the chances that the medication is probably the most effective medication in this instance. What about maintenance of remission? So if you look at all of these trials were designed as looking at responders to induction therapy and looking how effective maintenance therapy is. And here again, we see the effect estimates are largest for infliximab and adalimumab, and these two agents are ranked highest for maintenance of remission as compared to the other non-TNF biologics, or certolizumab. If we now try to infer what would be the estimated rates of induction and maintenance of remission anchoring against a placebo rate. So here the placebo rates are derived from a median of placebo response rates across all trials of TNF as well as non-TNF biologics. And with induction of clinical remission, that median placebo response rate is close to 16%. And here what we see that the anticipated rates of induction of remission with infliximab or adalimumab derived from the previous odds ratios is the highest, with 53% for infliximab and 42% for adalimumab. And similarly, for maintenance of remission, these rates are upwards of 45% with these two agents, significantly higher than other non-TNF biologics. We say that our clinical disease activity indices are probably not the most robust, and we talk about mucosal healing and risk of more patient-relevant outcomes, or more clinically relevant outcomes. A similar analysis was performed comparing TNF biologics with vedolizumab, looking at rates of hospitalization. And here we see that the rates of hospitalization are lowest with infliximab and adalimumab as compared to placebo. The effect estimate was also pretty low with vedolizumab, but the confidence intervals were crossing one. I'm going to acknowledge the limitations of such an approach. We do not have head-to-head trials, so all of these is based on indirect comparisons. There are subtle differences in trial co-interventions, although most of these were largely designed similarly in terms of the inclusion criteria. And finally, we talk about these as being registration trials. About 30% of our patients in our practice would actually qualify for these trials, so they have somewhat restrictive inclusion criteria. Let's move on to the next question. Is there any difference between the different anti-TNF agents that we have? This was based off a real-world comparative effectiveness studies that we did using the Danish population-based cohort. So this database includes all TNF-treated patients. All you can actually tell when they started their first biologic. So these are all anti-TNF naive patients. Close to 3,000 patients with Crohn's disease between the ages of 15 to 75. Anchored them on starting their anti-TNF. So between 2005 to 2014 is when they were exposed to anti-TNF. Ensured that they did not have any prior anti-TNF exposure. And in follow-up, we looked at real-world outcomes of hospitalization surgery. What do we know in comparing infliximab and adalimumab based off of this study? This is the schematic in which I'll be presenting the results. So comparing incidence rates of all-cause hospitalizations, Crohn's disease-related hospitalization, major abdominal surgeries, and steroid use. And for safety, the risk of serious infections, which are infections requiring hospitalization or IV antibiotics. And what we've largely found is that infliximab and adalimumab in biologic-naive patients with Crohn's disease are probably comparable to each other for most key outcomes. The rates of all-cause hospitalization were marginally higher with infliximab as compared to adalimumab. A similarly designed study now comparing infliximab with certolizumab that we did using a US claims database. And here what we found is that the rates of all-cause hospitalization and important patient-relevant outcomes were lower with infliximab as compared to certolizumab. This is, even though both of these drugs have similar mechanism of action, this is probably based off of ability to achieve adequate levels, adequate trough levels of these medications with conventional and approved dosing of certolizumab. It is hard to get up to a good level, which is why we may not be seeing the same level of benefit as we see with infliximab, where dose modification is much easier. We all talk that anti-TNF agents are probably not a safe medication and other newer therapies are safer. I acknowledge that the newer therapies may be safer, but what do we know from evidence? A similar network meta-analysis by Silvio Danese, who was here yesterday and his group, 44 trials of biologic-treated patients, close to 14,000 patients. Overall, the rates of serious infection in these clinical trials was 2.1%, and if we compare anti-TNF medications to anti-integrins, really no difference in the rates of serious infection, opportunistic infections, any infection or malignancy, albeit this is based on clinical trials with short-term follow-up. But if we start to think about what are the risk factors, I think this will help us inform as to how do we factor in relative efficacy. It's not just the medication, but other factors that play a part, and herein the efficacy would matter. So this was a pooled analysis of all adalimumab trials, close to 2,300 adalimumab-treated patients. 47% were on concomitant immunomodulators, 39% on corticosteroids. And in looking at this, the risk of serious infection was based on a higher baseline disease activity and concomitant use of corticosteroids. Keep this in mind. Similar results using the TREAT registry led by Dr. Gary Lichtenstein, very informative in terms of a risk of complications with these medications. And here again, risk factors for death in patients with Crohn's disease are prednisone use, narcotic use, and advanced age. And the same factors come up for risk of serious infections, moderate to severe disease activity, narcotic analgesics, and prednisone therapy. So making the point that the underlying disease activity and corticosteroid use is associated with an increased risk of infection, a corollary from this is if we control disease activity well and we minimize corticosteroid use, the risk of infections would be lower. And as my efficacy slides shown, the most effective agents that we have are anti-TNF agents in avoiding corticosteroids and controlling disease activity. So bear this in mind when we talk about relative risk of infections with different newer therapies. What is the risk of subsequent infection? We all get worried that once you have a serious infection, anti-TNF agents should not be used. This was a large claims-based study, close to 27,000 patients treated with anti-TNF, non-TNF biologics, or non-DMARDs. Again, a rheumatic disease study. These were 27,000 patients with serious infections. 81% were retreated with their index therapy, and about close to 5,000 subsequent infections. Here, what do we see? the risk of subsequent infections is lower with ongoing use of anti-TNF agent than with the use of other disease-modifying rheumatic agents or other non-TNF biologics, emphasizing the point that it is important to control the disease activity well, and retreating with anti-TNF agents is not an unreasonable option for these patients. And finally, listen to our patients. What do our patients say? This was a discrete choice experiment, 202 patients with IBD, 70% in remission. And our patients said, to avoid disease relapse over the next 5 years, they're willing to accept a risk of serious infection of 28% and a risk of lymphoma of almost 2%. Again, effective disease control is what our patients emphasize, and the best medication for that are anti-TNF agents. And finally, we do have a significant ability to optimize anti-TNF agents. All discussions regarding exposure-response relationships and trough levels are largely based off of anti-TNF agents, where we see a beautiful exposure-response relationship. Quartile 3 and quartile 4 tend to respond best as compared to quartile 1 and 2. This was studied in Crohn's disease in the AXIN1 trial, and similarly, post-hoc analysis of the SONIC study suggesting that higher exposure to anti-TNF agents is associated with higher rates of steroid-free remission. And finally, the concept of monotherapy and combination therapy, all concepts that we extrapolate to other medications are derived from anti-TNF agents. Again, rates of steroid-free remission higher with combination therapy. And finally, with the REACT study, we know that early combined immunosuppression, in this case with adalimumab and an immunomodulator, the risk of serious the risk of surgery, serious complications, and hospitalization were lower. So everything that we know about things that modify the natural history are based off anti-TNF agents, and early therapy with these agents is effective. So re-emphasizing the take-home points, anti-TNF agents are the most effective first-line agents that we have. Effective disease control and avoiding steroids is the best strategy to avoid serious infections. And every treatment strategy that we know of modifying the natural history of Crohn's disease is based on anti-TNF agents. And at this point, everything else is based just off extrapolation with other non-TNF biologics.